starts back, way back to my childhood.
Dear Diary, last week we left Canada and moved to England. It's very wet here, and the houses are really small, and the people are white, but like, really white. Apart from my neighbors, though, they're all black. I love my new friends. They have soft hair, and they dance real nice. I think I might be black.
Dear Diary, it's my final year of school, and I've decided I want to study medicine. Because I want to help people, you see. Like poor people and sick people. And especially old people. I love old people. I need to get really good grades in my GCSEs and A-levels so I can get into medical school. And God, if you're listening, please, please help me to be a good person. Help me to focus on my studies and suppress the sassy, sexy, fierce diva that inhabits me and is always trying to jump out and be all showbiz on my ass. Amen. Dear Diary, after 6 long years, I've finally done it. I'm a doctor. I can't wait for graduation day.
Shh, I think he's next.
Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm round of applause for our next successful graduate, Ahmed Kazimi.
So many years I've studied, 6 long years in total. It should have been 5, but I failed one. But hey, who's counting? All those lectures and exams, so many new things learned, half of which I'll never really need. But hey, it's done now, I've really done it. I've finally made it as a medic. The time is now to wear my crown, to heal the sick and earn a paycheck, and wear a stethoscope around my neck. I'm finally a doctor. My professors have passed on all their knowledge and skill. None have worked in a real hospital, but hey, who's asking? All of the facts and figures are safely in my head, though I'm told real doctors use Google. But hey, if it's there, I've really done it. I've finally made it as a medic. And wear a steth around my neck. I'm finally a doctor. Anatomy, physiology, pharmacology, gynecology, dermatology, gerontology, homeopathy. Okay, maybe not that last one. I've done my time, I've paid my dues. I really hope I'll be of use to you and you and you and you. I've really done it. I've finally made it as a medic. The time is now to wear my gowns, to heal the sick and earn a paycheck, and wear a steth around my neck. Finally, So, hello, AMSA. Welcome to Cabaret Consultations. I am Dr. Ahmed, and I am indeed your mystery entertainment. I'm really very excited to perform for you today, and I think I'm a little bit nervous as well, because I think this is the largest audience I've had in a fringe show on the circuit. So thank you for being my largest audience. But I have to be honest, I was nervous about something else more than I was nervous about your size. I usually cope okay with that. I was more excited when they told me that they were going to keep me a secret and a surprise until the last minute. And I was like, what if these guys are like expecting someone like Ricky Martin or something? And then I got even more worried when they told me the time slot. I was like, let me get this straight. You want me to perform a medical-themed musical at midday to 1,000 sober medical students? And then I have to say the organizers made me feel a bit better because they were like, don't worry, there is zero chance of the audience being sober. So I was like, I can make that work, all right? So speaking of sobriety, let's talk about medical school. So I made it through, as you can tell, got to the end. And it's okay, you don't have to clap. As you heard from the song, I did get off to something of a bumpy start, okay? But I think everybody benefits from an occasional failure slap. It's also called a thappad in my language. To kind of get your butt back into gear. All right, and I have to say, after the first year, the blip I had, after that, I was actually quite good. Got a few distinctions, won a few prizes, all right? And I wanted to share something with you, which you might be of interest to you. So if you'd like to see it, I've got an actual photograph from my real graduation day. Would you like to see that? Yeah. Okay, thank you. So, this is me and my friends. You could see I was a little bit more reserved back then. And the next photo I'm about to show you, I promise, is also genuinely really from my graduation day. Okay, you have a look. And I have no explanation for this. All right? So, you'll all know, okay, that when you study medicine, okay, at medical school, you're referred to as a medical student. And I think medical students are sometimes unfairly given the reputation of being a little bit elitist and a little bit cliquey and only hanging out with other medics, okay? And I don't think that's quite fair, and I'll explain why, all right? So you know, like in prison, how you have the main area of the prison for all the regular criminals. And then, oh, bro, I know you are not leaving my show right now. Is that what's happening? Oh, you don't have to boo him. He's already injured. But it's okay. So there's in the prison, there's like the regular area for all the regular criminals. And then there's usually like this outer annex, like this high security area for really bad criminals, like pedophiles and Pauline Hanson. Well, I think that is the medical school, all right? And I'm not saying that doctors are criminals, but I do think this kind of annexation means that we don't really mix with the other students. Yeah, is that fair? It's not without benefit, though. It does mean that, you know, this separation does mean, for example, if there was an outbreak of some serious illness, like chlamydia or pubic lice, then at least it's contained. Because remember, no mixing, all right? It's not all bad though, because the medical students are usually housed with the other healthcare students, all right? Or at least certainly this was the case in my medical school in Birmingham in England, all right? And I don't like to judge people, but you really could tell just by looking at somebody what subject they were studying, okay? And I will explain. So if, for example, you saw somebody in the medical school in full sports attire, always walking around in their active gear, you knew they were studying physiotherapy, all right? Or if you had a young lady in the library, everything was perfect, all her pencils are the same length, she was studying speech pathology, All right? But if you saw an international student or a white British student with pearls and jodhpurs, you knew they were studying medicine. Right? And I like to think I somewhat fit into both of these categories. International student, pearls, jodhpurs, all right? But yeah, so the... I'm just going to read my notes. 1 minute. Somebody put the dummy the wrong way, too. Just everyone close their eyes for 1 second. Do you promise? Okay, much better. You had one job, Dino, one job. Just teasing. Okay. This is usually the part in the show when I do it like in a fringe festival or something where I'll like try and build rapport with the audience and I'll suss out who are the medics or I'll find some medical students and then name them and shame them. But with 1,000 of you today, it is going to be a little bit difficult for me to build rapport one-on-one. So I've decided I'm just going to single out the two Kiwis. Thank you. What's your name? Mike. Is that what you said? I'm so glad you're here because I was worried I was going to make this joke and then the Kiwis will have already left for their flight and then my show would be ruined. So, does anyone think they've traveled farther than New Zealand for this conference? So are we all unanimous that they win the prize for commitment to coming to AMSA? I think Mike deserves another round of applause. Thank you. But in the medical school, okay, amongst all the healthcare professionals, there was one group of students, guys, who were cut from a different cloth, all right? They have a real mean streak. When I was younger, just a bad little kid, my mama noticed funny things I did, like shooting puppies with a BB gun. I'd poison guppies, and when I was done, I'd find a pussycat and bash in its head. That's when my mama said,
what did she say?
She said, my boy, I think someday you'll find a way to make your natural tendencies pay. You'll be a dentist. You have a talent for causing things pain.
Hey.
Son, be a dentist. People will pay you to be inhumane.
Humane.
Your temperament's wrong for the priesthood, and teaching would suit you still less. Son, be a dentist. You'll be a success. I am your dentist, and I enjoy the career that I pick. I am your dentist, and I get up on the pain I inflict. I throw and I drill a bicuspid. It's well though they tell me I'm maladjusted. And though it may cause my patients distress, somewhere, somewhere in heaven above me, I know that my mother is proud of me. Oh, mama. 'Cause I'm a dentist. Success. Say ah.
Ah.
Say ah.
Ah.
Say ah.
Ah.
Now spit. Thank you. So that was my little tribute to dentists. And that's the point in the show where I usually like to call out the dentists. But I have to say, doctors, we make fun of dentists a lot of the time, but we actually kind of love them, don't we? They're our brethren. And I think deep down we're also a little bit jealous because they usually have nicer cars and they only ever have to examine the one hole. But yeah, but I didn't study dentistry because I'm nice, not a sadist.
I studied medicine, all right? And I managed to finish my degree, and my first job as a junior doctor was indoors. It's not a striptease show, it's just, there's no other place to do it. So yeah, I'm just gonna put on my stethoscope for this bit because it will help you visualize me now becoming a junior doctor. So so I finished my medical degree, and my first job as a junior doctor was in London, in a big teaching hospital. And in England, in your first year as a doctor, you're referred to as a PRHO, yeah, which stands for pre-registration house officer, although for many of my colleagues, probably really hungover, also fit the acronym. And if you're wondering what the pre-registration bit refers to, it refers to the fact that you are so low in the pecking order that the medical council doesn't even want to take your details. All right? And they wait until you've successfully completed your first year as a doctor before they formally register you, because also, it is not assumed that you will make it to the end of the year. All right? It's genuinely kind of horrible, guys. Don't mean to scare you. But you'll spend years at medical school, you acquire all of this information, you've got all this theoretical knowledge, but then not that much practical skill. And there's a mismatch there that unfortunately only kind of time and experience is gonna fix, okay? And you just have to get through it. And I wanted to share a particular memory I had of my PRHO year, okay? So when I first got to the hospital, I was given this pager. Okay? And I thought this was the coolest thing ever. Like, you could literally be in mid-conversation with me, and my pager would go off, and I'd be like, my pager? And then I'd go to the nearest phone, okay, and I'd call back the number. Dr. Ahmed, house officer, you rang?
There's a vent Flon needs doing on Ward 4, now!
And then I realized very soon that they didn't really care what my name was. But I began very quickly to begin dreading my pager, okay? And to this day, if I hear a pager go off, it gives me palpitations. But when my pager would actually speak to me, when a voice would come out of the pager, that's when I would really poop my pants, all right? So if there were a cardiac arrest anywhere in the hospital, and it was your day on the on-call rota to be part of the team that dealt with it, the operator would talk to you down your pager, okay? Cardiac arrest, Ward 14. Cardiac arrest, Ward 14. And then you would drop whatever it was you were doing, unless it was holding a baby, and you would run to this cardiac arrest, okay? Now that sounds like a pretty straightforward decision, doesn't it? But it wasn't. It was agonizing, and I will explain why, all right? So first, I did start off running to cardiac arrests, okay? And I have to admit, I felt a little bit cool. I felt a little bit sexy. I was like, I'm in Baywatch. I'm a junior doctor. I'm going to a cardiac arrest. I'm going to save a life. And then I started to think, okay? What if I got there first? And I was like, I would have to know what to do. And then all of my seniors would get there after me, and they would all be watching me, and they would be judging me. And then I thought, oh no, no, this will not do. So then, I started walking to cardiac arrests. And I was like, this is much better. I will arrive cool, calm, composed. My thoughts will be collected. It's health and safety compliant. Zero trip hazard. And then again, you know, I started thinking, what if everyone walked to a cardiac arrest? What if the patient died on the way? So then I opted for this sort of half walk, half run, where sometimes the upper part of my body would be running while the bottom half was walking. And it was very characteristic, and if you ever saw this, you knew that that was a junior doctor going to a cardiac arrest, okay? You'll know it when it comes to it. You'll think about me every time your crash bleep goes off. But yeah, so I want to share another special memory with you, if that's okay. So I've got a photograph now for me and my best friend from our very first day ever as junior doctors, okay? So I'm going to put this up for you. So this is me and my best friend Nadia on the morning of our first ever shift, all right? And now, you're laughing at my sideburns, aren't you? And then it wasn't a fashion statement, it's because literally the hair doesn't stop anywhere. So I just had to decide one day most men stop shaving about here. But this is not a show about my facial hair. So we also took a picture exactly 2 weeks into the job, okay? And I'm now going to put that up for you. And just to allow you to fully appreciate the difference, I'm now going to put them side by side. And I think the difference, people, really is quite marked, isn't it? And this is after just 2 weeks in the profession, all right? Imagine what a lifetime would do to you. But I also have to say, I think, given these pictures were taken over a decade ago, I think I've actually aged okay. Thank you. No one's ever clapped at that bit, but thank you. Because it's true what they say, black don't crack. You know what else they say. Once you go black, say it. Oh, okay, this lady's like, I'll say it, you never go back. This lady's like, yeah, I got my white boyfriend next to me, I'm gonna say that. So, but, big round of applause for the lady who admitted it. So yes. So that's what it's like. But this is what ends up happening, okay? You do end up finding a place in yourself where you realize, you think, do you know what? Dino. Yeah, you sort of find this place where you think, actually, I got this. You think, I'm gonna be okay. My patients are gonna be okay. I will survive. At first I was afraid, I was petrified. Kept wondering why it was my patients wouldn't stay alive. Although I'd spent so many nights awake at medical school, I still knew shit was just an educated fool. And now I'm back on the wards. I just walked in to find myself practicing without adequate senior supervision. I should have called the nurse. Oh, this is terrible. I'm so sorry. I can barely hear the backing track. I think we should start this again. This is the best song in the show. Sorry. Ooh. Just do it again. And I'll have the fallback a little bit louder, if that's okay, and me a little bit quieter, thanks. You will survive. That's what I'm talking about. At first I was afraid, I was petrified. Kept wondering why it was my patients wouldn't stay alive. Although I'd spent so many nights awake at medical school, I still knew shit was just an educated fool. And now I'm back on the wards. I just walked in to find myself practicing without adequate senior supervision. I should have called the nurse's station. I should have woken up the consultant. If I'd have known for just 1 second how very hard this would be. Come on now, stand, get off the floor. You will be fine now. I don't have low confidence anymore. The knowledge is up here. Just need to learn the practicalities. Did you think I'd crumble? Did you think you'd lay down and die? Not on my ship. You will survive. Oh, as long as I know how to love, I know I'll stay alive. I've got all my life to learn, and you don't really have a choice. I will survive. You will survive. Hey, hey. All the
strength I had not to fall apart. Kept trying hard to mend the pieces of your ischemic heart. And I spent oh so many nights with my pager going off. I used to cry, but now I hold my head up high and you see me. Somebody new. I'm not that worried little junior doctor, not sure what to do. Now I can handle anything, headache, stroke, or torn hamstring. And I'm using all my knowledge for someone who's new to me. Come on now, stand, get off the floor. You will be fine now. I don't have low confidence anymore. I'm self-actualized into a brave junior doctor. Do you think I'd crumble? Think I'd lay down and die? Oh no, not I. I will survive. Oh, as long as I know how to love, I know you'll stay alive. I've got all my life to learn, and you don't really have a choice. I will survive. You will survive. We will survive.
Thank you. Oh, you're a very forgiving audience. Thank you. Very compassionate. Doctors of the future. So, when it's 2 a.m. and you're having a really bad day and you're questioning your life decisions, just remember this moment with Dr. Ahmed on the stage telling you, you will survive. All right? So, unless you've got acute kidney injury, in which case you probably won't survive, but that's different. So, I survived my PRHO year and I was promoted to senior house officer, or SHO, now fully registered with the General Medical Council. Sounds like a good thing, doesn't it? It's not. And this is the point in your career where you'll all know you cycle through various specialties to kind of gain a sense of all of them, to gain some experience, and to also to pick ultimately which is the one that you're going to choose as your bedfellow. And the specialty, though, really, the rotation, bless you. The rotation where you undoubtedly learn the most is accident and emergency, isn't it? Here is the place where you will see the full spectrum of humanity, okay, in all of its shapes and forms. You know, you'll see broken bones, broken nails, heart attacks, panic attacks, shark attacks, all right? And I'm sorry, but unless you have removed a retained tampon at 2 a.m, you can't call yourself a doctor, all right? You know who you are. I never understand it, it has a string, but anyways. So, and most of the time it's not even in there, by the way. It's already gone. But you'll come to know this too. Condoms, they are usually in there. So anyways, posterior fornix. Anyhow, not that kind of show. I thought you could take it, I thought you could handle it. I don't usually throw in the fornix bit, that was just for you. Laymen don't usually appreciate anatomical terms. But yeah, so I'm just, sorry to break the rapport, but I'm so glad you're joining the show, but I'm just wondering what this body language means. You've got your legs spread open and up on the chair at me. Am I reading too deeply into this? Is this the cat, because you're, is this just, what's your name? Luke, he hesitated before he said that, which makes me think that that might not be his real name. Can anyone verify, is this boy really called Luke? Or I think we should have a round of applause for how forward this young man is. I mean, he just, there is just no shame in it. Yeah, so, yes, I totally lost my train of thought. So SHO years, yeah, so you do A&E, and then that's where you learn the most. And I was thinking, okay, so if I wanted to convey to you, like the kind of, you know, the chaos and the madness of an average A&E shift. I thought, how could I do that? And then I realized the best way is probably through a musical medley, all right? So I want you to picture this, okay? It's a busy teaching hospital. It's 2 a.m. You're in the accident and emergency department. You're the resident, the intern, the RMO. And the department is full, okay? It's full of people, none of whom have had an accident or an emergency, all right? It's understaffed, you're tired, you've been there for 10 hours, and then you go to see the first patient, okay? So you pick up the little flip chart, and you call them through. Hi, I'm Dr. Ahmed, nice to meet you. So it's Miss, Kelly, is that right? Yeah. Oh, it's pronounced Kelly. Okay, Kelly. So, Kelly, I understand that you went out on a bender for your friend Sally's hen do. You drank 24 vodka Red Bulls, 12 West Coast Cruisers. You were then unable to walk in a straight line or speak clearly, so your friends were worried you might be having a stroke, and they brought you here. Is that correct? Have I understood correctly? Kelly? Look at me, Kelly. Can you tell me what happened, Kelly?
I come home in the morning like my mother says, when you gonna get your life right? Oh, mama dear, we're not the fortunate ones. And girls, we wanna have fun. Well, you girls just wanna have. That's all they really want. It's some fun when the working day is done. Yeah, girls, they wanna have fun. Well, you girls just wanna have fun.
Hello. It's not a stroke. And you call for your next patient. Hi, I'm Dr. Ahmed. Mr. Oh, Brody, is that right? Oh, I see you're from Australia. I love Australia, Brody. I lived there for many years, on and off. Where in Australia are you from? Cronulla. Okay. So I can see you're bust up real bad there, Brody. Brody, look at me, Brody. Can you tell me what happened?
Honey came in and she caught me red-handed, creeping with the girl next door. Picture this, we were both butt naked, banging on the bathroom floor. How could I forget that I had given her an extra key? All this time she was standing there, she never took her eyes off me. Now there's a rap bit, you want it? Okay, I'm not the woman access to your villa. Trespass and watch her while she clings to your pillar. You better watch her back before she turn into a killer. The next bit I didn't really know what he's saying, so I'm just gonna make it up and hope you don't notice. Rubba dubba dub, beaming in a big tub.
Okay. Right. Brody, is your girlfriend's name Keller? And then it's your last patient for the shift. Mr. Singh, not again. Mr. Singh, did you call the alcohol liaison nurse? The number I gave you. Oho number jo main likha si. Oho kagaz pe tusi unu phone kita si. Mr. Singh, have you been going to your AA classes?
But I say no, no, no.
No, no, no.
Yes, I've been bad, but when I come back, you'll know, no, no. I ain't got the time. If my daddy thinks I'm fine, try to make me go to rehab, but I won't go, go, go. I'd rather be at home with Reshma. I ain't got 70 days. And there's nothing you can teach me that I can't learn from Mr. Ram Prakash. I didn't get a lot in class, but I know it don't come in a shot glass.
Thank you. So, you'll notice those three scenarios had a common denominator, didn't they, guys? What was it? J- Just saying. Just putting it out there. And then do you know when I do this show in real fringe festivals, I'm not even joking, do you know what the cage questionnaire is? I make everyone do it. For real. But I omitted it for you because, you know. Do as we say, don't as we do. Now, you won't be surprised to hear that after my junior doctor years, I sort of decided, I came to the realization that I probably would benefit from an out-of-hospital, office-based, non-emergency specialty, which really, and no, I'm not referring to dentistry, which really only gave me the choice of two things, guys. I could either become a pathologist, sorry, I didn't mean to laugh when I said that. It just came out. We love pathologists, all right? So, I'm so sorry if your dad's a pathologist, like, didn't mean it. So yeah, I could either become a pathologist or a GP. And I like to think I'm kind of a people person, prefer working with the living rather than the dead. So I chose general practice, all right? And I do genuinely love medicine, and I did genuinely love medicine, but I guess I was just after that elusive 9 to 5. This is the only bit that's a sing-along, so you're gonna do it with me. Are you ready? Out of bed and I stumble in the kitchen. Ready?
Tumble out of bed and I stumble to the kitchen.
Come on, you know the words.
Pour myself a cup of ambition and yawn and stretch and try to come to life. Jump in the shower and the blood starts.
You don't know this, do you?
Out on the streets, the traffic starts jumping. Folks like me on the job.
Are you ready?
Working 9 to 5. What a way to make a living.
Get by. It's all taking and no giving. They just use your mind and they never give you.
He's dancing.
It's enough to drive you crazy if you let it.
Right, thanks. Sorry, my show. Cut the music. Eyes on me. No. Can we have the house lights up for the man who danced again? What's your name? Don't be shy now, man. You were proper twerking. It's Tarney. Thanks, Tarney. Where are you? UWA, or did you fly in from elsewhere?
Adelaide.
Oh my God, Adelaide is my second favorite city in Australia. Big round of applause. Perth is my first. I'm sorry, it will always be Perth, but I love Adelaide. Except Adelaide people are a little bit naughty, and whenever I say, "Oh my God, I love Adelaide," they say, "You're only saying that because you're here during Fringe." Always, every time. But so, thank you for coming. Anyways, moving on from Adelaide. So yes, anyways, so I finished my GP training, and I think nothing says GP like a diamond sequin jacket. But yeah, so I finished my GP training, and I realized very quickly, guys, that my life as a GP was gonna be way less Dolly Parton 9 to 5 and way more Rihanna. Work, 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 na na. That was a joke for the young people. So yes, and I also learned very early on as a GP that I really was going to have to learn a new language, all right? No, I don't mean because of the migrant population. I meant because I realized I was going to have to change the way in which I spoke to patients, and I was going to have to retune my ear to the way they spoke to me. So on a really simple level, for example, I had to extricate from my vocabulary all medical terminology. All right, so instead of saying patella, I would say?
Kneecap,
very good. Instead of saying scapula, I would say? Oh, he didn't actually answer that. I find that a little bit worrying. But all right. Or instead of saying clavicle, I would say? Not elbow. What medical school do you go to? Yeah, I would say collarbone, all right? But it works the other way too, okay? I realized that patients will go to exceptional lengths to avoid saying any words which make them even remotely uncomfortable. And often, they are very, like, not even particularly interesting words or embarrassing words. So, for example, feces, I can't believe you giggled at that. Feces, stools, opening your bowels. There's lots of ways in the English language to describe having a movement, yeah? But patients will not use this. No. So I'll have an older Australian gentleman come to see me, okay? And he'll be like, Doc, can you help me out, Doc? I'm in a lot of trouble. You know, Doc. You know. No, sir, I'm afraid I don't. You're going to have to use your words.
Okay.
Well, Doc, you know, when I'm trying to... You know, Doc, when I'm trying to... have sex? No, Doc, no! When I'm trying to... masturbate? Jeez, Doc, no! When I'm trying to drop the kids off at the pool! Sir, I wouldn't usually say this in clinic, but just so that we're really clear, can I double check? Are you referring to having a shit? All right? And I'm afraid women do it too, okay? So, I don't know why, but a lot of ladies seem to struggle to say the word. All right? I will be having an entirely lucid conversation with, like, an educated, sensible lady. She'll be like, oh, yes, doctor, it's been about 3 days now. It's really irritated. I've got really a lot of pain in my... Pardon? And they'll also use this whole raft of euphemisms instead of using the word. And I swear these are all real examples, okay? Mitzi. Bitsy. Cha-cha. And I swear, no word of a lie, once I had a woman refer to her vagina as her Katie. It was only halfway through the consultation that I realized she was not talking about her daughter. All right? And, you know, I like to test some of my jokes out on my friends, and I have, like, living room sessions before shows. And one day I was doing this segment, and I practiced this trick, and it was where people would volunteer what they called it growing up in their house. So I said to one of my friends, I said, oh, what did you call it growing up? And one of my friends, she's Latina, she's from Colombia, and she said, oh, when I was growing up in my house, we used to call it a churumbela. And I was like, oh, that sounds beautiful. It sounds like a flower or something. So now I'm just waiting for a Latina lady who has problems with her vagina to come to my clinic so I can say, are you having a lot of pain in your churumbela? But it hasn't happened yet. And in my house, when I was growing up, the word was fufu. But strangely, there's a lady tapping, like, yeah, that's what we called it too in our house. But strangely, my mother used this word for both female and male genitalia. It explains so much now, doesn't it? But anyways, it's always because of the mother. But yeah, so because of this anxiety around the word, I now don't really refer to it as that in my clinic when I'm consulting. So now, sorry, I call it a cooch. And I do this for a very specific reason. Because when I say, oh, ma'am, how many days have you been experiencing discomfort in your cooch? Ladies are very quick to correct me. Doctor, are you referring to my vagina? Oh, now you want to call it a vagina? Now you want to say the word? So, yeah, that's how I manage that small problem. Let me know how you do it. But it's not all bad, okay? I hope it's come across that I do genuinely love my job, quite enthusiastic about healthcare, but I also love to sing, and sometimes I like to try to combine things in my life. And so, like, I'll have a medical themed show, but I don't actually sing at work, but I do have a sort of musical soundtrack in my mind to go with, carry through during the day, and whilst I'm doing certain things, you know, I hear music, but not in a pathological way. I know the music isn't really there, right? But I'll give you an example, okay? So I might be excising a BCC or an SCC, and as I'm working away, in my mind, this is what's going on. You cut me open and I keep bleeding, I keep bleeding. Or, a couple comes to see me about a paternity test. Billie Jean is not my lover. or, oh, thanks. Young lady comes to see me because she's got thrush. This girl is on fire. Thank you. I think that's my favorite joke in the show. But yeah, so yes, I do have to say, thanks, didn't even have to say it. So, right, I do have to say that I do love my job. I love being a GP. I love being a GP. When I sit down at my desk, I put my stethoscope around my neck. I give you the results of your test. I tell you to take more rest. It's just you and me and your pee. I love being a GP. 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 When you're not feeling your best, you got severe central pain in your chest, I prescribe you things to help you digest. I tell you what not to ingest. I see you for free, dip your pee. I love being a GP. I love being a GP. Your specialist may well be a little bit smarter than me, but he's probably a bit of a interpersonal skills. He almost certainly wouldn't see you for free. I bulk bill. I love being a GP. I love being a GP. I love being a GP. I love being your GP. Dino. Now, so this show is a little bit about kind of my progression, my path of, ooh, become a, P's got a life of its own. Nitrite positive. So, that was just for you as well. Layman don't get the nitrite joke. Thanks. I've never seen a group of students this excited by nitrites. It's really good. Thank you. You're going to make brilliant doctors. So, yeah, this show is a little bit about, I feel bad now because now it's a really serious bit. But anyways, hashtag sorry, not sorry. So, yeah, this the sentiment of this show is a bit like kind of my progression, my journey of becoming a doctor, and how I kind of ended up being a gold sequin wearing doctor. And I think if I just told the kind of funny moments of being a job, of the job, I would be doing a slight disservice to the profession, because lots of our job is actually really serious. So with your permission, I'd just like to share one serious anecdote now, if that's okay. Yeah, about being a GP. So this time last year, I was working in West London, and I woke up to go to work, and I had about 50 WhatsApp messages on my phone. And they were all conversations from the other doctors at my clinic. And the senior-most partner in our surgery was really very concerned. He said that there had been a fire, and he was worried that many of our patients had been affected. And I didn't really have time to read all of the messages, so I just left for work. And then I went to take the tube, and the tube wasn't running. And the reason they stated was that it was shut down because of its proximity to the fire. And it was at that point that I started to think, maybe this fire was something serious. So I called an Uber, and I went to work in the Uber. And as I was nearing the practice where I was working, I could just see all these people lined up at the side of the street, and all looking up at the sky, a bit like, you know, in those end of the world films when there's like a comet or some natural disaster, like that. So I rolled down my window to have a look, and I couldn't see because the view was blocked by houses, but I could smell that the air smelled like smoke and burning. And then finally there came a gap in the houses, and I looked up, and this is what I saw. So it was an entire tower block that was on fire, and it was called Grenfell Tower, and it was less than a kilometer from where I was working, and we did indeed have many patients that lived there. And so I got to work, and I was a bit confused, and I didn't really know what to do. And I started making some phone calls about, you know, what were the facilities available? Was there a missing person bureau? Was there temporary housing? I spoke with the other doctor who was on that day at the clinic, and we decided that we would have open books, and if anyone came, even if they didn't have an appointment, we would see them. And people did come. They came within an hour or two, and they didn't come because they were injured. They came because they had no medicine, because they'd lost everything in the fire. And I was happy to help them, but I thought, what do you say to somebody who's just lost everything? They've lost their possessions, they've lost their home, they possibly lost friends and relatives. So I drew up the prescription, I gave it to them, and I just said what I felt. I said, I'm so sorry for what's happened to you, and we're here if you need us, if there's anything we can do, and here is your insulin. And later on that day, during my lunch break, there had been a rescue center set up for people who, whilst they're awaiting their temporary accommodation. So me and a couple of other doctors, I went to this rescue center, and I was actually very scared about what I would be walking into, and I anticipated, I imagined that it was going to be an environment full of terror and grief and sadness. And what I walked into in that small church was actually something very different. So all of the residents were in the middle of the room, and they were all surrounded by this kind of sea of helpers. There were doctors, nurses, people from housing, the pastor and the minister were there, and loads of residents were there bringing clothes, handing out food, handing out people that even come from different cities. There were so many people donating things that the church didn't have space and had to start refusing the things. And I don't know whether it made the news in Australia or not, but last year in England was kind of a horrible year. And the year was punctuated by terror attacks, acid attacks, Brexit. And London felt really quite divided and quite on edge. But I have to say, for those few hours in that rescue center, I felt like everyone stopped being black or white or Muslim or Christian or gay or straight. And for those few hours, everyone was just human. And I genuinely believe that if we're capable of that kind of cohesion and that kind of empathy and love under such dire circumstances, that we are fully able to do this on a day-to-day basis in our daily lives. All right? So that's just what I wanted to share about the serious moments of my job. You know, I worked there for a few more months. I learned a lot. And I really grew as a doctor during that experience. So that was my serious doctor story. And thank you. And this is usually the point at which I sing Wicked Game by Chris Isaak, and then everybody cries. But I figure it's way too early in the morning for a ballad, okay? So I've cut that one out. But I had realized even before Grenfell, okay, that life is really short. And that's why 2 years ago, I started the stand-up comedy. But deep down, I had always really wanted to do cabaret. Except I was a little bit scared. But then after everything that happened last year, I was like, you literally do not know what is going to happen tomorrow. So I said to myself, Ahmed, look, if you would now like to be a singing, dancing, comedy, cabaret doctor, go for it. Hashtag slay, hashtag work, hashtag can't touch this, hashtag don't smoke while pregnant, all right? So I decided that's it, I'm gonna do a cabaret show. So I told a few of my friends, and I discussed it with an industry professional who I work with, let's call her Rachel. And I have to say, Rachel's response to my idea of a medical cabaret show was a little bit lukewarm, all right? She was like, well, Ahmed, you might have had a bit of success as a comedian, but I mean, comedy's easy really, isn't it? I mean, who can't make a joke? But singing, now that's really hard, Ahmed. Don't suppose you're gonna tell me you can sing. Rachel, I can sing. Oh, sorry, it's a much larger auditorium, and usually I have time to give everyone high five. Sorry.
I didn't even make it off the stage.
Just give me some high five. Oh, oh, fuck, this is really hard, isn't it? Oh, oh, thank you, woo! So, then Rachel's like, that was quite funny. So, then Rachel's like, okay, Ahmed. Maybe you can sing a bit, but don't suppose your act tell me you can dance. No one comes from my moves, Rachel.
Up with it, girl. Rock with it, girl. See what I mean, girl. Bounce with it, girl. Dance with it, girl.
Okay, 1 second. Do you know that gets harder every year? Do you know the other day I was running and something was vibrating, so I checked my phone because I thought it was my phone, but it wasn't my phone, it was me. So beware, it happens, it creeps up on you slowly. So, give me 1 second, guys. So, yes, I am a doctor, and I love excising skin cancers and helping pregnant women stop smoking. But I also love singing and dancing and telling jokes, telling stories. And I have to be honest, sometimes I enjoy being the center of attention. Sometimes I like people clapping for me. And you know what? I think that's okay. Do you know why? Because I think life is about balance. And I also think, sorry, give me one more second. I also think you have to just be true to yourself. That wasn't Dino's fault, in fairness. This it wasn't. Yeah. So I think you have to be true to yourself. Even if you are a transvestite from outer space. How do you do? I see you met my faithful handyman. He's just a little brought down because when you knocked, he thought you were the Candyman. Don't get strung out by the way I look. Don't judge a book by its cover. I'm not much of a man by the light of day, but by night I'm one hell of a performer. I'm just a singing, dancing doctor from Canada, England, Pakistan, and Australia. Let me show you around, maybe play with sound. You both look like you're pretty groovy. Or if you want something visual that's not too abysmal, maybe I could show you my CPR technique. We interrupt this musical number to bring you an important announcement about effective CPR. On finding somebody unconscious, first call for help, then placing your hands firmly in the center of the chest, push down one third of the way at a rate of 100 per minute, like this. Well, you had a heart attack. Well, how about that? Well, baby, don't you panic.
By the light of the night, it'll all seem alright. I'll get you a musical medic. I'm just a singing, dancing doctor from Canada, England, Pakistan, and Australia. Why don't you stay for the night?
Night.
Or maybe a bite?
Bite.
I can show you my brand new obsession. I've got this pretend man with no teeth and no tan, and he's good for relieving my tension. I'm just a singing, dancing doctor from Canada, England, Pakistan, and Australia. Sing it with me! I'm just a singing, dancing doctor from Canada, England, Pakistan, and Australia. See, Tony, I wasn't lying. Adelaide is my second favorite city. So, that is the end of my show. But usually people say, ah, but anyways. I just want to leave with a closing thought, if you hadn't picked on it already, picked it up. So my kind of take-home message for you guys is, to quote the beautiful Tim Curry from the Rocky Horror Picture Show, don't dream it. Be it. Have you ever heard that expression? And whatever it is that you want to do, go for it. No matter how hard it is, or if other people don't get it, or if people judge you for it, or if you don't succeed, try again. Don't listen to the Rachels of the world. Do you know why? Because haters gonna hate, players gonna play, be a player, not a hater. All right? It's my other words of wisdom for you. And like I said, guys, life is really short. And we're all gonna die. And when you're on your deathbed and you're like an old person, dead person, dying person, thinking about your life, you don't wanna be all full of regret. You don't be like, oh my God, should have done this, should have done that. No, you wanna be like a dying old person who's like, cause I've had the time of my life. But if you leave it to your deathbed to reflect on whether you did all the stuff you need to do, you left it too late. All right? So the time is now. Don't dream it. Thank you. Do you know, in every show, people say, do it, and I'm like, okay, that's close enough. But you guys got it right. Thank you. So that's the thought I want to leave you on, and I want to sing one final song as a goodbye, and it's sort of my anthem in life. It's a French song, and it's a bit old school, but it's so famous, you'll all know it. It's Edith Piaf, and it's kind of my motto in life, is that I regret nothing. This is my goodbye gift to you. Thank you. J'ai allumé le feu, mes chagrins, mes plaisirs. Je n'ai plus besoin de balayer les amours avec l'autre mollo. Balayer pour toujours, je repars à zéro. Bien comme a fait.
gaffe ma vie, gaffe mes joies. Aujourd'hui, ça commence avec toi.
Ah, thank you. Oh. Thank you. Oh, you were one of the nicest, I think you were the nicest audience I ever had. And thank you. No one's ever lasted the, oh, I got a standing ovation from the boys in the middle row. Thank you. Oh, oh, that's so cute. Thank you. And I have to say also, no one's ever lasted the whole song doing that. So y'all got longevity. And while I'm up here, I just want to, while you're all applauding, can we thank the conveners and the organizers, because they've been doing this for a month. So well done to you. I wanted to thank the technical staff, because I've never had such a nice tech rehearsal. Like, they're so professional. It took 10 minutes and everything was perfect. So thank you to the tech people. I also don't want anyone to send Dino any hate mail, because he's actually really lovely and he did loads. Can we have a special round of applause for Dino? And I want to congratulate Monash on winning the debate prize. That's what had happened. Props, props, fist bump. Give me some love, give me some love. That's it. And I want to congratulate... Oh, what happened? Oh, did I... Oh, so come back, come back. Come back, come back, come back, come back. There's love for everybody. Come here, come here. I'll give you a hug. Oh. And then... and also, I would like to congratulate UWA for winning the real challenge. The sick people, you're gonna save lives challenge. Well done. So, I hope you had a lovely time. This is my social media, a little bit of a plug. Forget the Adelaide, because I already did that. But send me some Insta love, send me some Twitter love if you wanna give some career advice or talk about vasectomy or a job in comedy, let me know. Thank you so much, and I hope you all have a safe journey home. Bye.
Up with it, girl.
Oh,
rock with it,
everybody
girl.
Get up. See everyone get up.
Girl.
I'm gonna teach you how to twerk.
Bunks with it.
You ready?
Dance with it.
Wind it.
Twit it,
wind
girl.
It. Slow wind. Fast wind. Everyone, stand sideways. Trust me. Stand sideways. Everyone, look this way. Everyone, turn this way. Ready? Now, drop it. Drop it. Drop it. Hook. 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 Bye, guys. Oh, wait, wait, wait. I'm going to take a selfie because I never had so many people. Bye, guys. I'm really going this time. Oh.